that are typically reported by business brokers. And the business brokers have a copy of the financial statements of those companies, so they're going to put in there, they're going to put a copy of the balance sheet in there, a copy of the income statement, and you can look at what the actual price earnings multiple is. A lot of times in these cases, they use price to discretionary earnings, and discretionary earnings is like net income, but it's net income before you pay the owner, because even though the owner might work in the business, oftentimes they pay themselves a lot of money to do that. So oftentimes businesses, private small businesses, are analyzed on a price for discretionary earnings, so earnings before paying the owner.
Those PE ratios, are they looking for like industry averages, or how do they select it?
So in the case of guideline public companies method, what if I was going to do that, I would pick like say five. There is similar as I can get companies that you can actually go and look at their stock price over a period of time, and you the databases, you can go on any of them, Bloomberg, whatever, and you can get their entire financial statement right there. So you can just plot out over time what their price to earnings ratio has been. Obviously you want to look at it over a period of time, because what it is today might be skewed by some piece of news or whatever that happened that threw the stock price off. In the case of the guideline transaction method, that is just a sale of a company. Usually it's 100% sale. And so, you know, somebody buys a clothing store, they buy a plumbing company, small businesses, different databases specialize in different sizes of businesses that you can subscribe to. Once again, I don't use it here. Most of my company valuations are either in Cayman, or they're in the U.S. Virgin Islands, where I also have an office, or they're in Puerto Rico, where we have an office, and I've done a few in the Bahamas and a few in the BVI. But in the Caribbean, I just don't think that these U.S.-based multiples really apply, because mostly in major markets in the U.S., you have a much bigger pool of potential buyers and a larger market. It's just completely different when you're talking on this scale. And while businesses in Cayman can be very, and many of them are profitable, it's a very good place to do business. You have a lot fewer people that you can look to for buyers. So I typically stick to the income approach, which is what we're going to talk about next. As long as we're profitable, we can do an income approach and come up with a value that we think makes sense. And there are two primary methods of the income approach that we use. One's called the capitalization of earnings method, sometimes called a direct capitalization method, and the other is a discounted cash flow method. Capitalization of earnings method takes one shot. So you basically say, what is the cash flow going to be for 1 year on a stabilized, normal basis? And there are different ways to arrive at that. And we apply or divide by a capitalization rate, and we get to a value. So that's a one shot. It basically assumes that this income is going to continue into perpetuity. Doesn't mean there's not going to be any growth in income, because that's factored into the cap rate. But it means that it's not going to be 5 years and then you're shut down. So, for example, if you said to me, Jim, I don't want you to value my company. I want you to value my brand or an intangible asset like a patent or a contract or something like that. Those kind of things have a specific life that usually goes away, and that's why intangible assets are often amortized over a period of time. In that situation, that income doesn't continue into perpetuity, so we can't use that approach. But in the case of a business, in most cases, we're going to assume that it's going to continue unless there's a reason to say otherwise. You know, it could be you own a bar on a public beach and you only have a 10-year lease, or let's say you own the bar that's sitting on Dart's property and you know you're only going to have it until they decide to put a hotel on top of it. That would be a case where you can't do a capitalization of earnings, because you know there's a finite amount of time that that business, I mean, I won't say the name, but like Royal Palms, would be able to run. discounted cash flow would be the method that you would use. Let's say, for example, the owner of that bar wanted to sue because he felt like he didn't know when he bought into this business that there was going to be this sale. So you would do the valuation. You would say, okay, well, you've got 3 years of income and then you got nothing. So there's no terminal value. Basically, at the end, it goes to zero. And so you're valuing the cash flows for 3 years and nothing at the end. Whereas in the case of a company that does have an indefinite life, you put a terminal value on that. You value the present value of the cash flows for 5 years or for 10 years or whatever you think makes sense. And then you do this at the end. And you say, here's the terminal value. And you discount both of those back to present value. And that's how a DCF works, discounted cash flow. Also known as discounted future earnings method. So it looks like and maybe I've got an example, but it just basically looks like year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and you have, starting at the top line, you've got revenues, you've got cost of goods sold, you've got gross profit, you've got operating expenses, and you've got EBITDA, which is earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization. And then you've got cash, or you've got those things, depreciation, non-cash charges, depreciation, amortization, taxes, and then cash flow, which I'll talk about in a little bit, cash flow issues. And then you come down to the bottom line, and you've got a cash flow for years 1 through 5 or 1 through 10, and then you've got that final year at the end that you're going to capitalize. And you bring all that back to present value at a discount rate. And that's your value. So the discount rate, think of it as an internal rate of return or a yield, or a, depending on your background, what term you want to use for a return rate, a rate of return. How do we get the discount rates for equity in a company? Recently, I did a valuation on a very sophisticated business property here that has primary shareholders in India. And the guy, the CFO, did the valuation, and the transaction went through, and a whole bunch of people got bought out by all the other people. And the CFO from India called me, and he says, I don't understand why you discounted these cash flows at whatever it was, say 16, 18% or something like that. We just use the cost of our debt, which is like 5 or 6%. And I was like, so you're assuming that your equity interest in this business has the same level of risk as the bank? It doesn't. Equity has way more risk than the lender's risk, right? Because chances are the lender has collateralized assets, such as the real estate, that they can go take. You don't pay them. So there is a complete difference in equity yield rates and debt yield rates. You might only be paying 5 or 6% for the debt, but you're going to want a heck of a lot more of a return on your investment if you're going to buy an equity in a company and take on that level of risk, particularly if it's a small business and not a big public stock. So where do we start? We start with what's called an equity risk premium, and that is basically the systematic risk premium that we see in the equities market overall. So what's the return on equity for the overall stock market over a long period of time? That's where we start. So equity risk premium is the measurement of the systematic. The systematic, think about that as meaning just the entire, without any adjustments for specificness of this industry, this company, this location, anything. Just the systematic overall market risk inherent in purchasing equities or stocks in companies over and above the risk-free rate. That's why it's called a premium. The premium, I'll be happy to send you any of these slides you want. You don't have to take pictures. We start with the risk-free rate, which is basically like a treasury yield rate, long-term, like a 20-year U.S. treasury yield rate is a good place to start. It's about 3%. And then over and above that, what's the premium that you would pay for stock in a public company that overall the whole market? Like if you bought an index fund, an S&P index fund, that would be very symptomatic of the equity risk premium. So the size premiums, so we're obviously not going to pay the same. Remember how I told you before, we were talking about multiples of like PE multiples, how if you start with a big public company up here and they're getting a 10 multiple of earnings, you know you're not going to be a 10. You might not even be a 5 if you're down here under $1 million of revenue or something. So size premiums basically look at the premium and the equity yield that goes up for the increased risk as the size comes down. And there are all these different size brackets of companies that go all the way down to me.
I'm sorry, just want to step back a second. Trying to remember that premise of PE. Remind me?
Price to earnings?
Yeah, because you're talking about stock price compared to the earnings coming from a financial statement that might be yielding there, right? At each point, you're trying to plot. I'm trying to remember how that's derived again.
So price to earnings, if you like turn on business news and somebody says, you know, they're paying way more for this than the valuation. The valuation of this company would be X, right? Mm-hmm. And usually they're talking in terms of multiples. When they say valuation, they're talking about a price to earnings. What is the stock price today per share divided by the earnings per share? And usually that earnings per share is basically the net income after tax that's been reported in their most recent quarterly earnings, which are public for public companies.
And that would be different than dividends.
Yes, absolutely. Dividends dividends are as a cash flow expense. So net income is here, and then you have cash flow expenses below that. So let's say, for example, even in my company, you know, we have revenues, we have cost of sales, we have all our expenses, we pay our taxes, we deduct depreciation, or if we have that, any of that stuff, we get to net income. Then that's kind of the money that that's available to pay. Well, it isn't, because it's typically on an accrual basis. But theoretically, it's the money that's available to pay dividends with. But you might not just pay dividends, you might do what we did this year. Instead of paying ourselves dividends, we went and bought more stock in the franchise. So, which I'm kicking myself for now because I need money. But we decided, I have two junior partners in Puerto Rico, and the three of us decided that we needed to buy more stock in the franchise because based on our company size, we should have more, and we did that. Different story. But after net income, you can have all these things that affect your cash flow. And one of the things you can do is pay dividends to your stockholders. So that comes after earnings. Earnings are what you have available to pay dividends with. And some stocks pay dividends and some don't. Some companies reinvest all their earnings. So that's the big question right now if you're invested in stocks, is with the reduction in the corporate tax rate in the U.S., what are these U.S. companies going to do with the extra money that they don't have to pay? Because the corporate tax rate went down from 35% to 21%, even though a lot of companies don't pay that. Theoretically, they have all this extra money in net income that they could either pay their shareholders with in dividends, or they can reinvest it back into the company. So the companies that don't pay dividends reinvest it back into working capital to fund new research and development, to expand, to buy more assets with, and do all those other things. Mm-hmm. Or maybe to pay their CEO way too much money.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Going back, actually, you were talking about the income approach.
Mm-hmm.
For the capitalization of earnings method, the cash flow divided by the cap rate, but the cap rate is the inverse of a multiple of cash flow. How do you find that multiple?
Okay, we're going to build up a discount rate. We're going to convert that discount rate to a cap rate. But you mentioned inverse of a multiple. That's exactly right, because theoretically, if you looked in the market, in your market approach, and you found sales of companies that made absolute sense, and you said, well, this is dead on, you know, I'm a six multiple or whatever, you know, one divided by six is your cap rate.
Okay.
Now, that's true and not true. There's a little nuance to that. Is typically when we use cap rates and discount rates, we're talking about cash flow, whereas those multiples are on earnings, which is net income.
Okay.
So it's two different baselines, which are slightly different in most cases, but because if you're in accounting, you know that we want to use accrual accounting, right? So everything, if you want to account, you're accounting for your income whether you got the cash for it or not. It's in your receivables. And your payables, if you didn't pay the money, it's in payables, right? But here's your net income on an accrual basis, but you might not have gotten any cash, right? When we capitalize cash flow, we're capitalizing cash flow. We're doing accrual accounting, though, converting that net income to cash flow. So really, it's the difference between how much cash did you have at the beginning of the period and how much cash do you have at the end of the period is cash flow, if you've ever looked at an audit. So that's a different number than net income, whereas earnings multiples are usually based on net income, which is not a cash flow. Earnings on an accrual basis are a better way to measure a company's performance, right? But small company businesses are valued on a cash flow basis.
Okay,
awesome.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Your cap rate, is that saying how long it will take for you to make back your money? Is that what the cap rate is?
That's a great way of looking at it, because in real estate, you might have heard the term, there's something called a YP or a year's purchase. It's basically flipping that cap rate back to a multiple, the inverse again, and saying, you know, a 10 cap rate would mean you basically have 10, it's your 10 years to make your money back. Yeah.
And the other thing I'm looking at, the price, the PE, is that a way of saying you're paying too much for a share, or you, like for instance, you buy a Microsoft share and it's a PE of 10 as against
mm-hmm.
Another one with PE of 5. Is that something you're looking at and say, okay, this one I might be paying too much, it might be have this earning, but I'm not going to make back as much money as buying a one that had a lower PE. I mean, could that be a way of looking at the price earning ratio there?
So there are all kinds of things that are factored into those ratios. Say, for example, somebody actually did a discounted cash, because these companies publicize their projections, right? They have 10-year projections. And one company, Microsoft, might factor in that they're going to release a new Windows. And then if you're comparing Microsoft to Dell, obviously you have a completely different PE ratio. Even though they're similar industries, one's got a much brighter outlook for the next 10 years because there's going to be this, and this happening that's going to forecast a much higher income going forward. So even though you're paying on the earnings that they just released, you're factoring in what you think is going to happen in the future. And that's all factored into that ratio. That's why a company with a bright outlook is going to have a much higher PE ratio than an equal company that doesn't.
But from the perspective of the investor, one thing that company is going to make you that money. But from the perspective of the investor, could it be that it may not necessarily be the best if you buy Microsoft shares because really you're paying too much for it? Could that be a way of using the PE?
Yes. I mean, I think that that's exactly what analysts do. I mean, they, you know, analysts and fund managers and even financial advisors, basically that's how they spend their day. They look at the stock prices, the PE ratios, and they say, does this make sense based on what this company is doing? And if there's a proposed merger in the works, or if there's some, you know, reason, you know, to seriously consider either investing or divesting in it, that's what they do. So yeah, that's basically what analysts do. Yeah. I don't know if I answered your question or not. Okay. So we're building up an equity discount rate, and we started with the risk-free rate, and then we talked about the equity risk premium, which is basically the systematic overall market risk in the equities market over and above that risk-free rate. And then we talked about the size premium for smaller companies, because you're going to pay less for a smaller company, so there's a greater amount of risk. And then you have industry risk premiums, which are based on the measurement of yield rates for companies in different industries, less the equity risk premium. So we have this thing called beta. And beta, 1.0 beta means that's your equity risk premium. That's like the S&P index fund, you know, right across the board. Then let's say you ask me about the value of a company that does, you know, pharma. And pharma might have a 1.2 beta because for whatever reason, the market perceives that there's less risk. More risk in pharma because of all the R&D that goes into it, and because, you know, new products, new patents, and all those things carry a lot of risk with them and uncertainties. So, you know, that beta, that 1.2 beta, basically translates into an industry risk premium, if you will. And that's kind of how that's measured. So you have Duff & Phelps actually does a huge study. Now it's all online. You can subscribe to it. You can get quarterly updates. And they're all the time updating these betas that they use to calculate industry risk premiums for dozens of different industries. They have it for the U.S. and they have it for international, some of the major countries in the world as well. So, because different countries have different risk rates as well. So a lot of what we're talking about tonight seems to sort of gravitate towards the United States, partly because I use a lot of U.S. data, because our economy here is so innately tied to the U.S. economy. There is some market risk premium in Cayman that's over and above what there is in the U.S. for identical companies, but that's a different story. We would capture that in a country risk premium. But you have industry risk premiums that are based on these betas. It's kind of getting a little bit technical, but basically what they're doing is the computers over at Duff & Phelps are analyzing, you know, all these different stock transactions for different industries, and they're figuring out over a long period of time what these averages are compared to the average of the whole market. And therefore, trying to come up with the different risk associated with different industries.
It feels almost like we're talking about insurance at some point.
Yeah.
They're trying to put it in a bracket that tells you or not that pipeline you can literally focus your investment interest in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so back to this. So the risk-free equity discount rate, basically. And keep in mind, we're talking about equity here, not invested capital. That's different. Equity discount rate is the risk-free rate plus the equity risk premium, which is the overall market, and then the industry risk premium for that particular industry. I didn't put it on here, but you can actually add a country risk premium if you're not, you know, if you're looking at U.S. data and you want to add a risk premium for here or some other country. Pleasure size premium, and then we sometimes have to add a company specific premium, and that really gets into, you know, the nuts and bolts of looking at a specific company and saying what makes this more or less risky. And let's say, for example, it's a medical practice, and instead of having 20 doctors, it's got one, and that guy is really well known in the industry, and he's got personal goodwill attached to his name, and if he leaves and goes away, it's risky, right? So those kind of things would attract a higher company risk premium. Or if, you know, let's say your company is doing something that's maybe going to go away because it's becoming obsolete, less technologically advanced, or whatever, all those things can attract a greater company risk premium or a smaller one. I'll come back to real quickly the country risk premium. So one of the ways that's if you're really interested in this subject and you're a complete geek like I am, there is a professor, his name is Aswath Damodaran, and he's a really savvy, smart guy that is professor at NYU Stern School of Business and Valuation. And he's got a spreadsheet that you can download for free online. Basically, what it does is it calculates, it's theoretical, but it calculates the ratings, like the Moody's and S&P ratings for sovereign debt in different countries. And it looks at that in terms of the increased risk of investing in that country versus another country. And it comes up with basically a country risk premium that you would add to the US-based data. Now, if you type in Cuba, you're going to get a huge number. Or Venezuela, absolutely huge. Cayman isn't on the list because we're not a sovereign territory, and it's sovereign debt issues that we're dealing with. You can actually invest in government bonds here, but they're not rated by Moody's or by S&P, so we interpolate. But for many countries, you can actually just type in the name of the country, and it just does a computation, and he updates it regularly depending on, you know, how Moody's, repeatedly or regularly change their ratings on different countries depending on how they evaluate. One of the issues, though, I have with it is when I'm looking at a small company, I don't know that the risk in a small company, let's say, you know, I did a business in St. Vincent, and it was a flour mill, rice mill, wheat mill business, and a lot of the products were sold in St. Vincent, the Grenadines, but they were also sold in Barbados, and they were sold in other countries in the Caribbean. And their products were imported from Canada, their raw products. So when I looked up what the country risk premium would be based on Damodaran's spreadsheet for St. Vincent, it was actually pretty high because the sovereign debt risk is pretty high for that country. But my question is there a same level of risk premium added to a private business like that you would compare to the government? And I don't think there necessarily is, particularly when a company is selling to different markets. So they're not just reliant on the economy in St. Vincent, and they're certainly not just reliant on the government of St. Vincent to meet its debt obligations. So the question you have to ask yourself is really, how much does the public sector debt equate to the private sector debt?
Well, wouldn't the government have a lower premium as against a private company, since the government was not being bankrupt?
Well, you're going to pay a much lower price for bonds. I mean, you're going to get a lower yield on bonds than you will on most equity stocks for that very reason. But when you compare bond ratings in one country versus the U.S., U.S. kind of being the baseline of a low-risk country to invest in their bonds, then you can get an idea of how much the increased risk for one country would be versus the U.S. is the point. So if you're using U.S. data for this, and you're doing a company that's outside of the U.S., you might have to consider that there's additional risk there. And it could be currency. A lot of times that's the risk, because let's say I value in Eastern Caribbean dollars, is there a risk that some of they're going to have to devalue the EC dollar because the economies in so many of the EC countries are sucking wind for a long period of time? You know, and that kind of thing. So if there's a currency risk, then that can affect the sovereign debt rating of those countries, because somebody's going to go invest in bonds in whatever country currency they're in, U.S. dollars or whatever, and then kind of assume that the currency is going to stay the same, but it might not.
Well, so the point is that if at the government level, let's say there's a premium of 3%, if you are valuing a company in that same country, you put a higher premium when you're evaluating, or you'd be looking at how the business is trading. It is international, and it's have a good base, not just depending on what economy. You may give that a lower income.
Well, that's where we talk about the company-specific premium. You know, if that company has a really good outlook because of their place in the market, et cetera, then we would put a lower company risk premium on it. The country risk premium is specifically apples to apples, one country versus another.
Question. Yep. Can you extrapolate from, say, the difference in a two countries' bond yield to then say, okay, I'm starting a business in
well, Mexico.
Where there's Mexico,
there's a lot of information from Mexico, but let's say you're talking about, you know, a small Caribbean island where there's not that much. You know, we use the tools we have. So, you know, for example, if we have this sort of Moody's rating to go on, it gives us an idea of how much analysts, you know, that are trained to do that can grade or rate the risk of that country versus another. Is that sort of a pressure?
Okay, yeah, it's kind of, if you can use that, I guess, to build on, the bond rate,
mm-hmm.
to build on for an industry that may not be there, or so that's very
different. Can
different
you, sorry,
in a small way.
Say the bond, you're referring to government bonds or some corporate bonds.
Government bonds, how you said that professor has
mm-hmm.
this tool where you can compare country to country the risk based on their bond yields. Can you use that to measure risk in a country where there's no information or very little information on something that you're researching?
Well, that's exactly what we're talking about. So, you know,
how do you apportion, say you want to sell widgets, and no one's
mm-hmm.
ever sold widgets or a service, and they've never done that. And mm-hmm. you've got, the U.S. has, I don't know what the bond ratio is right now,
mm-hmm.
but one's 2%, and then in Mexico or wherever, it's 10%. Where do you go from there to even build? So they say, okay, well, you've got 10%, and now you have this new service. Or this new
When you say you want to sell widgets, I mean, I'm assuming you're talking about starting a company or becoming an entrepreneur or something like that. You have to look at what is your comfort level in terms of your level of risk that you're comfortable with and what kind of return you want. The more risk, the higher the return that you're going to want on it. So for a place that's relatively safe to do business, the risk level might not be so high. So you're comfortable spending a little bit more for the same sort of potential cash flow than you would be in a country that's a higher risk. But this is talking about how Moody's rates the risk of those bonds. So they're graded. So for example, you know, U.S. might be AA-, and that's given a 10, you know, and Barbados might be, you know, AB- or whatever it is, CAB-, you know, and I don't have it memorized how they're graded, but Demodin's spreadsheet does that, and it basically applies a grade to each one of those ratings and compares them. So a 1 or a 5 versus an 8 or an 8 versus a 10 or whatever gives you a relative risk premium. So it might come up to be 2%, 3%, 4% premium that you add to this discount rate. But that's just kind of like valuing the company. So it's really up to you. Like, you have to look at all the circumstances involved. If you're thinking about investing or, you know, starting a business, everything from the specific market and who you're selling to and what's the regulatory risk, what's the currency risk in that market, are you buying all of your supplies from outside where you're going to have to pay US dollars, but what you're coming back in revenues might go down in value because of the currency might go down in value. All those kind of things you have to factor in to determine your own personal risk comfort level.
I was going to say something also. If I was just thinking it through in Central America, and other countries I've been working with, one of the things you could do with the bond is, to look at bonds, even especially from government standpoint, the risks inherent there, I guess we could say, it's looking at the stability of how much, how well they're paying back,
mm-hmm.
their performance, track records on paying back the interest to the for those that have bought into the bonds, it's the way to service the bonds,
mm-hmm.
the performance across that board, it indicates the risk level, of course, the gradings and so on. Look, I guess you can build a picture from that point.
Yeah.
And that's what I've been having to do, basically,
right.
Look at how they've been servicing that based on the instruments I've been dealing with, and from that point, be able to grade it to see how you can then capitalize on that knowledge to extend it to other investments.
Yes, and I think, that's kind of what DeMoneyron did, is he built a framework for converting those levels of risk into quantifying it in terms of adding to a rate, and it doesn't mean he's right, it just means this is one way of quantifying it.
When you were speaking about just a rate, I think you'd have to also consider how easy it is to repatriate your funds from a country, not just the equity discount rate or what they're going to pay. How, so you can, like in China, I guess maybe they'll allow you to come in and do business, but how easy it is for you to get your money out of the country after you have invested.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to liquidate a business, how easy it is for you to do that. So I guess that's another aspect you need to consider beyond just the return you're going to get on your money.
Absolutely.
I've actually faced that when I was investments in Belize, and you have put money in, but taking it out is another thing. But you do have offshore centers that you are technically in the country. You operate and invest independent of the restrictions they have in the country, and easily move dollars in and out. So there's always some means of getting things in and out, but it's just the way you operate that makes a difference.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We're getting actually past time. I think I was supposed to take an hour and a half plus maybe a half hour question, so I'm going to try to get through a few more slides for those of you who've got a few more minutes. And if you have to go, I completely understand. I've got cards here. If you want me to email you the slides or anything else, then just pick up some cards and send me an email, and I'll happily send you the slides or answer any questions that you have, but I'll try to get through a few more slides for those of you who can stick around a little bit longer. But if you have to go, I understand. So discounted cash flow is the sum of the present value of cash flows and the present value of the terminal value at the end of the period, discounted at the equity discount rate. And both the market and the income approaches depend on the income, and that's why, because the multiples in the market approach that you're using on earnings are income-based valuation, as well as when you capitalize an income stream. One of the things I wanted to get across, and I should have put this probably at the beginning of the slide deck, is avoid the pitfalls of using rules of thumb. One of the first things I come across is people ask, somebody called me up the other day, he was a real estate broker, and he was considering trying to sell somebody's business for him, and he says, I hear that like a 7 multiple or a 5 multiple is right for this type of industry, and, every risk, every business is different and carries different risk. That's the first thing. Like, you can't just blanketly say, oh yeah, you should get a 5 multiple for that kind of company or that specific industry or anything like that. So, I really, really strongly caution anybody against just blanketly putting a rule of thumb on something. There are books that you can go online, you can buy books that have different industries in them and what typical multiples and rules of thumb are. There's no data in there. It just basically says, for a, fast food restaurant, this is the kind of multiple people play, and sometimes it's without real estate and add real estate to it, that kind of thing. The other thing is that the parties may be working from financial statements that are not normalized. When I quote a fee for doing a valuation, what I try to do, first of all, is figure out how long it's going to take me to normalize the financial statements, because if they're not accountant reviewed, and even sometimes if they are accountant reviewed, there are things in those financial statements that have to be normalized because there are irregular transactions that don't regularly happen. So they invested in something and they expensed it instead of capitalizing it as an asset, or they hold real estate on their books when they shouldn't be. They should be leasing it to themselves, or lots of things that we have to fix in the financial statements, because if we're valuing just the business and not the property that they're in, we're looking at it from the point of view of the buyer. We're saying, if I'm an investor coming in, what am I going to pay in rent, not own the property? And, there are also situations where, and I don't understand why Cayman business owners do this a lot, but they run their personal expenses through the company. Well, you don't pay taxes here, so, maybe you do if you're American, but...
Some don't need to keep financial statements.
Yeah, well, and that's where I can't even, I can't even start if you don't have financial statements. But I try to gauge how long it's going to take me to do that. That's probably the most time-consuming part of the whole valuation. I have a template that I plug in, 5 years of income statements and 6 years of balance sheets, because I have to have a starting point at the beginning. And, all those elements have to be plugged in and attributed to some sort of normal account. And then I normalize those by making adjustments. So I might have to adjust something in the balance sheet that shouldn't be there. And then I have to adjust on the other side. It's going to affect retained earnings. Or if we're normalizing cash, somebody keeps, here's something that happens all the time. I value businesses that keep way too much cash on hand. So... And then I value their company, and the first question that's coming out of their mouth, well, does that include all the cash I have in the bank? No, it doesn't. It includes a normal amount of cash. So if the normal amount of cash is 10% of assets, or it's 12% of sales, or whatever it is every year, we normalize the cash, and we take it out of cash. It affects retained earnings on the bottom end of the balance sheet. Doesn't affect the income statement, but here's your value based on cash flow. And then you can do what you want to with the cash. You can add it back at the end, or you can keep it and say, you're not buying this cash dollar for dollar, whatever you want to do. But that's the kind of thing. Even if we have an accountant-reviewed financial statement that's perfectly IFRS or GAAP compliant, it doesn't matter. We still have to do normalization adjustments, and that takes time. So that's one of the big reasons why we don't just say use a multiple, because then you might be applying it to an earning that might not be right.
Sorry, I just want to go back to that point in the real estate bit. So they having that real estate on the books and not leasing it out for themselves.
Yeah.
So where it sits on the books doesn't really see a contributed cash flow in any way, shape, or form. So it can obviously be undervaluing the company in some respect.
Well, it does. So in the situation where, a guy owns, say, if our office is an office condominium unit, I don't own it, but if I did, I could theoretically not pay any rent to myself and put it on the company books, and then therefore the company makes more money because it's not paying rent. So it's there. But the reason why I don't do it that way is because real estate can, most kinds of real estate, this is different than a hotel or something like that operates as a business. But in the case of an office condominium unit, or even an industrial building where somebody has their factory in it, those real estate types of real estate can be sold separately and are sold separately often. But if you're coming in and you want to buy that business, you might just be interested in the business and not the real estate. And it's certainly easier for you to buy the business without having to buy the property as well. And I know we're not dealing with taxes here, but if you were dealing with taxes because of your citizenship or whatever, it makes perfect sense for you to hold real estate separately for a lot of different reasons. And so we always pull the real estate out unless there's some reason not to. Even at a restaurant, restaurants often do, say 50% maybe, I don't know, own their own real estate instead of paying rent to somebody else for the real estate. And even if they don't own the real estate, oftentimes they put a significant amount of cash into the interior upkeep to build out the space and make it look they want to look. Mexican restaurant, Italian restaurant, whatever it is. But those leasehold improvements are good on the balance sheet. You need that. But the real estate can easily be leased. So we pull that out. And then if you're paying a mortgage on it, we pull the mortgage payment out, we pull the debt off the balance sheet, we pull the interest payments out, and we add in a rent. What's the market rent on that space? And we add it in as an operating expense for the company. Because you want to see how the company would perform normally paying rent on a normal basis. So these are all the reasons to make normalization adjustments. Balance sheet, income statement, non-regular transactions, personal assets and liabilities, keep the personal stuff off your books. We capitalize fixed assets and inventory rather than expenses. That's something we see very often is people will buy equipment or inventory and just run it through as a supplies expense. And instead of capitalizing it as an asset. And that throws off your ratios. And we mark our assets and liabilities to market value. Particularly in tax jurisdictions, they over-depreciate or hyper-depreciate assets because if you expense that depreciation, you're paying tax on a lower net income. So, but here, if you're not paying tax income taxes on your business, then why are you hyper-depreciating your assets? So after 5 years, you've got all this equipment sitting there that you're still using and it's generating income for your business, but it's got a zero value on the balance sheet, we correct that, we fix it.
So what rate would you use for depreciation? Internet, for instance, you have a machinery, and you say, okay, since you're not doing for the purpose of taxes, what rate would you use, length of number of years would you depreciate that asset?
Well, you know your business. So if you're a beauty salon and you've got a hair dryer, how long does a hair dryer last? I don't know. But it depends. Like, you know, different.
So basically, the more realistic thing rather
yeah.
than the, what that's
how long is it going to last you before you have to replace it? Because one of the reasons to do this as well is capital expenditures. Remember, we're capitalizing cash flow. And capital expenditures is something that happens below the net income line. When you take that money that you can either pay out to your shareholders or you could buy more stuff with it, if you have to go out and replace your equipment because it's all old, that's capital expenditures. So we usually want to see capital expenditures exceeding depreciation by some amount. So if your depreciation is 5% of sales, capital expenditures should be somewhere between 6 and 10% because you're going to have to go back and replace the depreciated items with new items. And that's one of the things that we do to normalize cash flow.
And then you're normalizing the balance sheet. It's basically for comparison purposes. Because this one say, okay, I own my property, but this one over it. It's to compare the two financial statements. No, it's not like apples that you compare.
Correct.
Apples, really.
Not apples, apples, that's right. So, although we need accrual accounting, everybody understands what that is, right? When you earn an income, even though you might not have received it yet, it counts as income. When you owe a bill, even though you haven't paid it yet, it counts as an expense, et cetera, et cetera. We need that because shows the true performance of a business. But we're capitalizing cash flow. And cash flow, for example, cash flow to equity is net income. Then you add back your non-cash charges because you might have expensed depreciation and amortization. That's not a cash item. It didn't affect your wallet. So you add that back, less your capital expenditures. So for example, again, after net income, you might have had to go and buy more stuff, buy more equipment. So capital expenditures, less increases to your working capital. So what does that mean? You had to take some of your money and buy more inventory. Also your receivables. So for example, you could have had a great year. Sales might have gone from $500,000 to $1 million that year, but you didn't get $500,000 more in cash because half of it went into receivables that you didn't collect. So that's why that's part of increased working capital. Receivables are part of that working capital. And then if you've paid off your debt any or you've taken on more debt, that also affects your cash flow because it's not a cash item. It is a cash item. So here you have accrual-based accounting right down to the net income level, and then we convert it to cash flow, and that's actually what we're capitalizing into value. And we're applying that capitalization rate or that discount rate to come up with a value of the business. You can also look at cash flow to invested capital. Remember, invested capital includes your equity and your debt. So it's very similar. Net income, you're adding back non-cash, so that's depreciation and amortization, less your capital expenditures, less increases to working capital, plus plus your interest, because we're not considering any sort of debt-related expense. And that gives you the cash flow that's available to service both your equity and your debt investors. So if you wanted to get somebody to value your business, and you were thinking to yourself, how can I increase the cash flow? Because that's going to be what's going to increase my value of my company. Again, come back to the guy who's increased his sales hugely this year, but he didn't collect. He's got it all in receivables, but he didn't collect the cash, so he's not getting benefit of that cash flow, right? You've got to be diligent about your collections, and you've got to minimize your receivables to a point that it's normal for your business, right? You can't let these things go on for months and months and months without collecting them, because it affects your value of your company. So minimize these cash flow deductions, reduce receivables by being diligent at collections, don't overspend on inventory. One of the things that hurts the business big time are companies that sit there with dormant inventory that they're not going to sell for a long period of time. So be diligent with your inventory, and I don't know if we're going to get to it, but there's all these ratios you look at. So turnover ratios, inventory turnover ratios is basically your cost of sales divided by your inventory. Tells you how often you turn over your inventory. If your inventory is turning over very slowly, then you're spending too much on it and you're not getting the cash flow benefit. Try not to let capital expenditures far exceed depreciation of assets. So, this is to say you need to take your working capital and put it into the assets that are going to help increase your cash flow. But if they're not doing that because you're overspending on equipment that's not substantially resulting in your sales being affected, then you need to look at that too. So, we have all kinds of slides on these ratios, and quite honestly, it would take too long to go through them. But again, if you want to see the slides, these ratios are good for us as valuation people to look at how the business is performing. But they're also good for you if you own your business to sort of fine-tune your business and see where you're doing well. Because there are industry ratios. You know, what's a good current or current ratio is simply current assets divided by current liabilities. That shows you how solvent your company is, ability to make short-term obligations, that kind of thing. You know, what should these ratios be in your industry? And you can look at the ratios and see how your company is doing and maybe work on it. So things like turnover. Inventory turnover, payables turnover, receivables turnover, how fast are those turning over in your industry is important, because if you're not performing that well, then you can look at that. So really quickly, five solid business practices for enhancing business value. Maintain solid financial statements. Number one thing you can do. Good accrual-based, have an accountant review it, and have solid financial statements. Keep your business and your personal stuff out of it. So if you have your own car, that's fine. If you're using it for business, great. But if you're just driving it to and from work, maybe it shouldn't be a company item. Or your cell phone and that kind of thing, whatever. Understanding benchmark ratios and margins in your industry. And there are sources of that information. Use leverage optimally and responsibly. So there's a whole slide in here about how to manage your leverage and your debt. But for small businesses, getting good leverage is hard. Most small businesses, particularly here, don't have any debt, because you can't get any anyway unless you find additional equity investors that are willing to take a chance on you. If you don't have securitable assets, you know, that you can collateralize, like real estate, why are banks going to lend you money? They might, but it might be at a pretty high interest rate too. So you have to manage that and consider whether or not that it is actually leverage. If you're paying high interest on debt and you're not going to increase your return on your assets to a greater degree, then you're not leveraged. Move personal goodwill to your team and your company. So, you know, this is the example of a doctor who sells his practice. He's probably not going to, the one doctor who owns his practice or the dentist or whatever, he's not going to sell and walk away that day. He's going to sell off over a period of time, and he's going to stay on as a consultant. Maybe he's only going to sell 25% of the shares today and another 25% next year, and over a 4-year period of time, he's going to phase out. but he's gonna gradually translate or transfer his personal goodwill over to the new doctor. And that's how you get value for your company. But if you're not selling, but you have a team of people under you, maybe you decide, you know, you go to an industry conference and you market and you network and you do it yourself every year. Maybe this year you decide to send your manager, your best guy, and you send him. He starts becoming the face of the company, and you have your clients deal with somebody else besides you. There are ways to do that to try and get some of the personal goodwill away from you, because it's only going to detract from the value of your business if you try to sell it. So that's my advice. It's hard for a lot of people to do, because, you know, my business is my baby, right? I built it, so you know, I like the fact that it's me, but, you know, I'm not going to do this forever, and somebody needs to buy me out at some point.
I mean, that also extends to the fact that you might at some point want to franchise it or something. I mean, you started small from scratch and
mm-hmm.
you're looking at expanding. I guess you're looking at those kinds of options at some point in your growth.
Yeah.
That could really build up. At some point, you want to maybe capitalize on franchise option or go into partnerships, even merge with other companies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's, you know, one of the reasons why, you know, I took on these partners in Puerto Rico, even though Puerto Rico is a difficult market to work in right now.
I was going to ask you about that.
Yeah, but it's a complete diversification, and.